Hello.
Hi. Woo.
How lovely to see you. Well done, you guys. You're all here.
Welcome to Comic Con, everybody.
Hello.
Now, to all of us in the press, this seems like a slam dunk, but actors would be actors unless they had doubts and insecurities. Jodie, what are you nervous about?
Straight to me.
What are you nervous about?
Today?
No, about taking on the role. Yeah.
It's a funny one because obviously it's an iconic show.
You
know, it's huge. Amazingly loyal fan base, and it was obviously a nerve-wracking moment for the reveal to see how that reaction would land, and it seemed to see positive. I'm not on social media, so I translated it that it was 100% positive. No negative comments. But I think actually being the first woman to play the Doctor is incredibly liberating. There's, you know, with this role anyway, and ask any of the previous Doctors, the rules are out of the window, because the most wonderful thing is you regenerate. So you can bring everything from previous, you know, you can make it your own and stay loyal to it. And casting a woman doesn't change that. So I'm not nervous.
Yeah. Over to you, Lad.
The Doctor's still the Doctor, and I'm not sure that's in some situations I would agree that there's gender issues, and I think particularly when we go into history, that might come up. But I think generally in contemporary worlds, alien worlds, things like that, the Doctor's still the Doctor, and the Doctor is very capable of walking into a room. I'm not sure that's a gender-related issue, certainly not for the way we're writing it, certainly not for the way it's being performed. The Doctor is that character who can walk into a room and through force of personality, force of charm, force of being amazing, totally bend everybody to their will, solve the problem, defuse the bomb, make everybody happy, get out alive.
More than most, this show carries a pretty brand ambassador, let's say, cachet to it. Could you talk about adjustment to the extracurriculars of, you know, bringing this show to the public, stepping into stuff like this, and stuff that all these would be going to, and...
In regards to our responsibility as...
And adjusting to it. I mean, it seems bigger to hear than it would for a lot of other shows.
Oh, I say it was, and the huge, how it feels for us to be, I suppose, the forefront of a very famous show.
I've not really thought about it, to be honest. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. We're really like wrapped up in a bubble in Cardiff, and we're just getting on with it and creating the show, and I guess I've genuinely have not thought about what it brings, but I know that there's a level of responsibility, and I take that into any job, regardless of whether it was on this scale or any other scale. I think I'm just going to stay with this.
I thought Hall H had about 1,500 people in it.
I'm just going with the flow.
In the promotion for the show, there seems to have been a shift in referring to the companions as friends instead of companions. What is the significance of that?
It's not an edict or a rule. It just feels a bit more natural to me and to us. And yeah, I'm not sure you can walk into a room and go, "Hello, I'm so-and-so, these are my companions." You walk in, obviously, this is me and my mates. And it probably speaks a little bit to the 13th Doctor's kind of egalitarian, she's got a gang of mates with her. But it's it just feels a bit more emotionally connected contemporary language, but it's in no way a rule for Whovians from now on.
No.
if they started off with good assistants, and then it was companions, and then it just was a natural thing to sort of start talking about. There's lots of mates and lots of friends.
Thank you.
do not want to talk about the TARDIS. The TARDIS
exploded, so who knows?
But in regards to it as a bigger question of bringing it to the Doctor, I think it's interesting because I have never approached a role thinking it as how would a woman play this role, because I just am one, and I don't know if a guy has ever gone, how would a guy do this thing? You just are, and it's your POV. So essentially, my energy, my approach to this is coming from a very instinctive place, which feels genderless to me because it's never been necessarily ingrained to me that that's a specific way a woman behaves and a specific way a man behaves. But the best thing about the Doctor is I'm not playing either. I'm an alien. So, you know, so there's really no rules. I've got two hearts, so I can do whatever I want.
This question is for everybody. Are you looking forward to exploring the past, either like the present or even like the future, as far as like episodes?
Without saying we've done that, I'd absolutely love to go back and go forward, do present day things. For me personally, it would be to learn loads of things that we may not have got taught in school or we forgot about, or, you know, things that I think about, whether they're out there or not. So yeah, completely. Whether we have or not.
Yeah, to see cool things like in space or universe or different planets and stuff. You always see that on Earth, you know what I mean? And different gadgets and that type of stuff. So I'm just looking forward to seeing cool stuff and learning new things and experiencing new things and stuff like that. So.
And when we see it, it'll probably be the first time we've seen some of the things as well, because obviously a lot of our reactions have been to a tennis ball. So for us, it'll be to wear it, and that our gender, and that's mainly where this came from. And then there's so many little details that you never can find.
Hello. For Matt and Chris, you guys obviously have incredible diversity in front of your camera, and I'm curious if that was a priority behind the camera as well, in particular when it came to who you got for writers and directors in this season.
Yes, is the short answer to that. Yes, we have the first license in colour, that's one of the opportunities here. We've two female writers and three male writers in the guest writers slots, and we have split as well. We've two female directors, two male directors across the series.
So all our apart from one of our editors are female. The vibe around it was really important to Chris and I and our production team to make sure that we are as diverse behind the camera.
Hey, there, it's 2018, everybody deserves a moment. No, it's 2018, we just got hit with the times and crack on.
It was a big priority for us. Yeah. And there's also something we're doing behind the camera with an organization called It's My Shadow, which is about young people coming into the industry from backgrounds who don't normally get the opportunities that we've got. I think they're based in Cardiff and we're working with them, and there's another 7 trainees working with us. So we're doing lots. I mean, our big thing across time would be to do lots more. But
it's providing training opportunities as well, and sort of using, we had this term when we were putting it all together about like the academy, an academy feel to it. So I mean, you could bring people on, because often you know people need to know that the business is for them as well, that it's fully inclusive, and sometimes people haven't felt that, they felt a barrier to entry. And so creating training opportunities across the board in all areas of the show is something that we're really keen on, the BBC is really supportive.
Plus, it should be the most inclusive show ever. Absolutely. You know, the whole concept of Doctor Who is anybody can go anywhere and do anything. And you want to look like that. On screen, off, walking the show.
Over here. Based on that inclusivity, I'm sure you're getting a lot of questions, Jodie. You know, what would you say to young girls who are watching the show for the first time coming to reach you back? What message would you have for young boys who are watching the show?
That it's okay to look up to women, and that is exciting and not to be feared. And also just, you know, I think that's the thing is, like Chris has said, and how we all feel is this is a show for everyone, but I think us three sitting here didn't always have, when we were growing up, necessarily people on television that looked like us, but me and Mandip sounded like us. Not many people have our accent, unfortunate for them. But you know, and I suppose it's just that the heroes don't have to tick the same box, and but like, you know, like Tosin said, it's 2018. I mean, the fact that we are having these conversations now, and also, you know, as a woman being the front of a show, it'll be really exciting when women are treated as a genre, you know, just as a cast member. It'd be great. You know, if you lead a show, it doesn't mean it's for women, which I think is, it always happens within it. And so when you've been thrust into a kind of a genderless role, this is incredible, but it could also, you know, let's not have this conversation in 2020. Hopefully.
My question is maybe for Amanda and Tosin. Can you tell us anything about your characters?
Anything.
Not necessarily the plot, who they are.
I play Yaz. She's a 19-year-old girl who went to work and I guess just thought she could do more, asked for more, got more, so just be careful what you ask for. And went along this adventure and found a family away from home. She's completely in awe of the doctor. So initially the doctor says, Joe, she says, how am I? And she's really up for it, and then there's this huge like shift towards the end, and you find them, they're both getting to the same conclusion by the end of it. And she has a really nice relationship with Tosin's character and with Brad's character, Graham, who's not here. And there's just this great dynamic between the three of the friends and the friends with the doctor. You know, we all bring something completely different.
Yeah, right. You know, he's a chap, you know. He's just normal day life, you know, going by it, and then just gets caught in a crazy situation. Then he just kind of goes with the flow. It's like a crazy moment, and he just enjoys the ride as it goes on more and more and more. He's more of a boisterous type of group, you know, he challenges a lot from time to time. He gets it right sometimes, wrong a lot of the time. So yeah, it's kind of finds its way through his journey, and yeah, that's me.
If we could do two more questions, just because I know people have flagged that they have another press conference to attend.
Hi, as someone who's been watching the show since the Rusty Babies era, from my observation, whose fandom has always contained a sizable portion of women fans, what is it about now, 50 some years into the run of Doctor Who, that makes it the right time for the Doctor to be in a woman's body?
I think it was possibly overdue, to be honest. I mean, I think it. I can only speak to since I've been in the job and when I got to make the decision, and it felt really simple and obvious, and the world was ready, the show was ready, the audience were ready, I think the fans were ready. There have been obviously lots of mentions of it in the show before, so in terms of canon, you can point to things, but actually, Rusty Davis texted me the other day, going, I think there's a mention in Hand of Fear about regeneration, somebody turning male to female, so it was canon back in 1976 or whatever. There was an amazing list of actresses who could do this part, and we were then lucky enough to get the best person on that. Actresses as well, so it was more. No, that's what I said to him. It was a no-brainer, is the short answer.
Great, last question.
Okay, you mentioned that the TARDIS has obviously exploded, so we will see a new one.
I didn't say that. Well, I said it exploded.
Yes.
You said it.
What can you tease about the look on the inside of the new TARDIS, or any inspirations, or what can you tell us? And for the actors, can you just talk about walking onto that sort of iconic set for the very first time?
No. No, I'm really sorry, because it exploded.
Do we know if we walked onto it?
Yeah.
Where's
that TARDIS?
Yes.
If it's exploded, how are they going to back?
I think people love to speculate, and what's lovely, what we've noticed in social media and in the press, is that there there are so many great theories going around about what's going to happen and who's going to be in it and what it's going to look like, and that's fantastic for us because we can decide.
Nobody's mentioned Percy the Cat, which I wrote about the papers.
So,
you haven't asked about that, you've missed an opportunity.
Thank you to our panel. Thank you for everyone for attending. To that point, we are going to share this episode with the world at the same time. So BBC America will premiere it as a simulcast with the BBC in the UK. Thank you again. Have a great Comic-Con.
Thanks, guys.